Well, it's good to be home. We did a little traipsing around East Texas. We played at the Bar None Cowboy Church for New Year's Eve. And New Year's morning, and did their Sunday morning service. That's a big old church out there. And really, really nice folks. I didn't know cowboy churches could get that big. But they got horses. I guess they got 12, 1400 members out there. So we didn't practice this week because we've been playing and playing and playing. So we're just going to play some of the stuff we know. Kind of. We still know. We're going to do Thank You, Lord, because my Bible says you enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise.
Thank you.
fast.
Thank you, Lord.
So it's that one string. It takes one to make a mess. One link in a chain. And a body of Christ, one person, can make a world of difference. It could be you. You know, it's so good in the house of God. We're gonna do more stuff.
Thank you. Then Jesus is nice, he and I can have more stuff. He promised to provide for us, take it low, it's be enough. And the Father longs to bless you, that's the nature of his love.
I think I knocked it out of tune again. I think it was fine until I bent the neck a lot. It's so much fun to do that. Cloudy day. This is on page 10 there, Jim. Looking at a hillbilly hymnal. Is everybody feeling pretty good today? Y'all have a good New Year's, good Christmas. Got your seatbelt on.
Oh,
Oh yeah. Let's just turn the page over and do victory in Jesus while we're at it. Page 11. Trying to slow this train down. Yes. I do too.
Y'all ready?
Yes.
I played this one in a while.
Well, I hold on to my ghost, how my Savior came from the Lord, how he gave his life on Calvary to save a wretch like me. Well, I heard about his grace, his blood atonement. I repent today of my sin, the full victory. Oh, victory in Jesus, my Savior forever. He sold me and he bought me with his redeeming blood. Well, he loved me. Yeah.
Thank you, Mike. Don't Mikey look good in a cowboy hat? I make him wear it, but I won't let him take it home. He's got too many miles on him. This is an old Chinese gospel song. It's called Tuning for Jesus. I've used that too many times. I ain't gonna get away with it no more. I didn't really get away with it even the first time. Trying to buy some airtime. Pastor still likes it. This is our prayer for y'all. Thank you. ain't it? I guess we got a little special thing today, but I do want to wish happy birthday to someone. It's her birthday.
January 3rd.
Well, happy birthday to you. And happy birthday to Elvis. He would be 77 today. Same age as Elvis. Man, how you can't get no better than that. Anyway, God bless y'all.
Sill, hit you on the head, and I thought, well, you know, okay, but God is good
all the time.
And all the time. This week, funny turn of events. I was driving down the road and heard a song on the radio, so I run home and I grabbed my telephone, which my wife's slowly teaching me how to use. And I looked it up on the internet, and it had this video that goes with it. Talking about a powerful, powerful, powerful song. So, looked up the video, which spurred on a Bible study, PJ and I, which then was reinforced when Kirsten started reading her Bible. And you don't... Are we there? Okay. And you don't get any more confirmation than that. So, I called up Ty and said, hey, you know, I got this video, and told him about the video, and he looked at it, and I said, can we play that at church on the big screen? He said, I'll ask Tori. So, if the video does not play, it's Tori's fault. But before I go into the scripture, I want y'all to see this video. I want to share it with my brothers and sisters here.
Can't hear it over here. Yeah,
can't hear it
now. Can't hear me? No, over here.
Hello? Hello? Can you hear me now? Turn it up. You notice how the speakers quit when I got up here? I think that's by design.
Okay. Hello. Hello. Can you hear me now?
Hey.
Hello. Hello. Hello.
Keep talking.
All right. Hey,
okay,
I keep talking.
I can do that. I can keep talking. All right. Hello.
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 There we go.
Oh, well.
Sure, fix it for him. Won't fix it for us.
All right. So, this video, very powerful video. Hello.
Now it's loud.
How's that? Better. All right. I'm talking. So anyway, this very powerful video, I wanted to share it with everybody. And is that good? All right, I'm gonna move out of the way real quick.
is exactly how it's supposed to be.
I'm right here. Can you hear?
She looked up something on the internet, and she said, what was salvation? It took her to this site. Man, it was an awesome site. You know, we got a lot of good Bible study out of it. Well, the thing about it is, the major part of salvation, well, I guess the first part of salvation, is repentance. And what is that? What is repentance? Repentance, by definition, is a change of mind. And it brought me to several scriptures. The first one was in Luke, when John the Baptist was talking, and this is in Luke 3. John the Baptist was preaching and baptizing him, and Luke 3 and 10, he was talking about repentance. And they said, well, what should we do then? And John answered, he said, the man with two tunics should share with him who has none, and the one who has food should do the same. 12, tax collectors also came to be baptized. Teacher, they asked, what should we do? He said, don't collect any more than what you're required to, he said. Then some soldiers asked him, and what should we do? He replied, don't extort money, and don't accuse people falsely. Be content with your pay. Change your mind about who Christ is. Because when you change your mind, the outward evidence of this will be a change in behavior. In Acts. Acts 3. If I can remember where. Acts 3:8, I believe it was. I can't remember where that one was. And moving on. And I'm still lost. So I couldn't remember these things this morning and I didn't write them down. So I had PJ run them up real quick. And I put my markers in. And anyway. I can't remember where those were. They were good scriptures. Basically what he was saying was that these guys came to know Christ. When you come to know Christ, it's evidenced. It's evidenced by what you do. You know, and people have asked me, well, people have said, you know, after I am saved, I still sin. Is God going to forgive me of that? Yes. Case in point. Here a while back, I bought a truck. It's a 1996 Chevrolet, one ton with a flatbed. By no means is this truck new. It's new to me, but it was not new. So last night, I got the sermon on my mind, not paying attention to a lot of stuff. I had to load a bunch of pallets on the back of it, and I'm headed home, and about 20 feet out of where I was coming from, I hear this pop and smell antifreeze. I knew what it was. This water pump has been seeping since I bought it, you know. Just check the water, you know. I heard it pop. I knew what it was. But, you know, it's kind of a guy thing. You got to open the hood and look at it. So I did. Yeah, that's a water pump. So the man that I was working with, he gave me a ride up to the parts store, bought a water pump, come back, and I spent a lot of last night turning wrenches. And he said, boy, I bet this makes you mad. I said, yeah, you know, not really. Not really. I knew it was messed up. And I should have put a water pump on it when I first got it, but I didn't have one of those round two-its. I figured when I got a round two-it, I'd put it on. Well, the thing is, just because that truck messed up, did I hate it? No. I fixed it. And when I fixed it, I drove it home. Christ died a horrible death, as you saw in the video. Horrible death to fix us. Now, we're going to sin. I had to ask forgiveness this morning for something I did. We're going to sin. But it's our attitude toward it. If instantly we feel remorse and we ask God to forgive us, the Bible says in Psalms, He separates as far as the east is from the west. 1 John 1:9, if you confess your sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us of all unrighteousness. You're fixed. Yeah, we got parts that wear out. We got parts that don't work right. But when He puts those parts back on, when He fixes it, it's fixed. There's a man brought a saddle to me last month, and he said, the riggins broke out. Can you fix it? Well, shoot, yeah. Rip the seat back, jerk the riggins off, cut some new ones, put them back on. Lined them with rawhide. And I said, if these riggins break out again, you need to quit roping trains. If the riggins break out again, bring it back. We'll fix it again. But see, when I fixed it and I lined it with that rawhide, as Casey's built saddles, he'd probably tell you, that ain't breaking. The one thing I know, leather will tear, rawhide don't. It's like iron that you can bend. So when I fixed it, I told him, this won't break. If it does, I will fix it, no charge. But he didn't throw the saddle away because it was broke. He got it fixed. Christ does not throw us away, or God doesn't throw us away, just because we break every once in a while. Just because we break down. He paid a price for us. He paid a very hefty price for us. He's got a lot invested in each and every one of us. He's not going to throw us away because of a breakdown. How many of us buy a brand new car and if it breaks down, take it back, buy another new brand new car? How many of us can do that? No? I can't either. Not unless it's Hot Wheels. Those I can do. But see, I can't stress this enough. I guess the video was all a sermon we needed this morning, but He made it new. He made everything new. When you become a Christian, when you have that salvation, when you pray and say, God, fix me. You might not be new in the world, but you are a brand new creation. Because He took you in and overhauled you and gave you a new soul. Listen, I cannot stress it enough. If you don't know Christ as your Savior, if you do not know Christ as your Savior, you're going to break down one day. Now, that water pump, as soon as it broke, I fixed it. And that truck drove right on home with no problems. Had I not fixed it and just kept going, there would have been no hope for that truck because it would have broke and I couldn't have fixed it. Steve's back there saying, I could have. But you understand what I'm saying. I would have run the engine and then I couldn't have fixed it because we couldn't afford a new engine. But listen to me. If you're going along and you do not have Christ in your heart, if you did not have Christ to fix you, You're rolling along with broken parts. And one day, you're going to break down and there's no hope. Absolutely no hope. And no mechanic in the world can fix you after that. When you stand before our Lord and Savior, and when I say stand, I mean probably going to be on our face crying. But when you're before Him who made the world, made us, it's too late. It's too late to put that raggedy old part back on. If you're here today, you've never started that relationship with Christ, never talked to Him, never asked Him to forgive you of your sins, what you've done in your life. You've never had God fix you. I ask you to follow me today in a prayer. Simple prayer. You don't have to say the same words I do, but the meaning in your heart. Because if you do not truly believe that Christ died on the cross, and believe me, this is not lip service. You can't just say these words. This has to come from your heart. If you do not truly believe, it don't work. Lord, I'm just a sinner. I'm running around, broke down. Lord, I need your saving grace, and I need you to fix me, put new parts on me. Lord, I want to be able to roll through life down here knowing that I've got a lifetime warranty here and an eternity warranty when I leave this earth. Lord, I ask you to clean the sin out of me, fill me up with your Holy Spirit. I ask you to walk with me every day. Lord, I ask these things in your Son's holy name. Amen. I want to read one more thing to you. And this one I do remember. God was talking to Moses on Mount Sinai. Y'all remember he had the big tablets made of rock. God wrote himself. He walked down the mountain, broke them, had to go up and get another set. The rules God said. The first one said, I am the Lord your God who brought you out of Egypt and out of the land of slavery. He said, you shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven or on the earth beneath or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them to worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for their sins and fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. If you take nothing else away from today, understand something. We're all broke. We're all going to sin. We're all going to mess up. Okay? The question is, in your heart, do you have that salvation and that saving grace? God, I'm sorry. He fixes us and sends us right on back out to the churches. It's been said that it's environment. You know, an abused child grows up to be an abuser, the cycle continues. You know, he abuses his children; they grow up to abuse. If at one point in time, one of these children in this line. Says, I'm not doing this, and breaks that chain, a new cycle continues. That's what God was talking about. That your sins will be revisited on your children and your children's children until one time you stand up and say, I'm living for God. Like Joshua said, as far as me and my family, we serve God. Okay, and when you do that, to your children will start seeing the change in you, and they will want to serve God. And then their children will do it. And then their children, and then their children. And generations upon generations will start serving God. But it's got to start with you, with me, with us right in here. Not only do we have to confess our sins, but we have to change our mind. And in doing so, change our actions. Because actions speak louder than words. And if you change your mind and you change your actions, you will change your children and your children's children and so on. If you need to talk to me, I'm going to grab my cup, fill it full of coffee, and sit down in there. Please come and sit and talk to me. Please do not leave here without knowing for a fact you have that salvation and that saving grace and that super mechanic to fix you. Because if you do not, your quality of life when you die seriously diminishes. If you don't want to talk to me, you know what, that's all right. You ain't hurt my feelings. Look around you. Grab somebody. Grab one of the lay pastors. Grab one of our wives. Just grab somebody in a shirt and a pair of boots or tennis shoes or flip-flops or whatever and say, hey, what was he talking about? What is salvation? Google it. I don't care. But do not leave here today without knowing that you know Christ as your Savior. Where's he at? Fritz?
Jump so fast. There's no back door here, is there? I gotta go out the front door. All right, let's do Happy Trails. Ready? Smiling on to let's have a little word of prayer before y'all run on out of here. Father, thank you so much for bringing us home to our church and our family here. We just ask that you would bless this house with unity, peace with one another, and in our lives as we go about our daily duties. Just bless us with your grace. Walk with us. Lead us by your hand. In Jesus' name, amen.